Because I need to introduce myself. Is there anyone to introduce yourself later? But my name is Andrew. I'm a consumer of Visa, internet governance and child online protection with a telephone communication with the administration and regulator. So this is our second symposium. We held one last year here. This is the second. And we hope that today will be a fruitful discussion. Before we proceed on, I'd like for us to open this session with a word of prayer. So I'll ask you to close your eyes as we say a word of prayer. Our Father, which art in heaven, we want to praise you for a beautiful day today. And thank you for the time that you have allowed for each and every one of us to be here to discuss this issue with the internet security, which is of great concern and importance to this nation and world. And we pray that you will lead us well today until we finish with some achievements in Jesus' name we pray. With this, I believe you have one agenda, hard copy. If you don't have one, please indicate and we will have one given to you. So, this morning, as you can see, we'll run quickly through the agenda before we have the introduction. Just we will have an opening remark by the regulator, followed by presentations. We have social media, then Facebook challenges from OGCIO, and then the OGCIO will brief us on the cybercrime bill that is going before Parliament very soon. And then we'll have Barry again from Domain Name in New Zealand on media and social media and privacy. And then we'll have one user experience on a Vanuatu case of cybercrime. That will be done by Valentin. And then after that, we'll have morning tea. We'll have morning tea. And after morning tea, we'll have our first panel session that will be on social media and cybersecurity. And we have two main questions to discuss, which is how secure is Facebook? What are the privacy issues when used in social media? And our panelists are there, and unfortunately some of them are not here, like Gerard and Sachad, but we will make some changes to that. And then we'll have lunch at 1 p.m. for an hour, and then we'll have afternoon session, which starts at 2. We'll have presentations on cybersecurity and network security in general, and then on third we are fortunate to have a representative of APNIC here, Claire, who will be running those sessions, and then we'll have afternoon tea. And then we'll go into our final panel, which to discuss CERT or computer emergency response teams, and that session will lead us to a closure at 5. So that's basically our agenda for today. I believe that you come prepared to contribute to what we want to achieve. And by the end of the session, we should be able to have some volunteers who will be in a working group that will be working towards a national set. So that is basically our day today. We will start now by having our introductions. I'll pass the mic around, and please just say who you are and who you're representing, and and then we'll move around that room.
Yes. Good morning, everyone. My name is Kenton Milroy. And I'm representing Vanuatu IT User Society. Fighters. Thank you.
Morning, everyone. Jackson from OGCIO.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I am Michael James Kenton, and I am TRR at Legal Officer. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. I am Balan Nechmudu, representing TBL.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Arnaud Grosleron, and I'm representing EBS Engineering Business Services Limited.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Thomas Leroy. I'm also representing EBS.
Good morning. I'm Carlo Ribeiro, representing the Acting Commissioner of Police.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Tope Isaiah, and I represent the Reserve Bank of Vanuatu.
My name is Felix. I'm coming from OTCL.
Brad Partridge from the Regulator's Office.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Norman, representing the ARA.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Donna. I'm from the VFSC, Vanuatu Financial Service Commission.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Frederick. I'm with the Supervision Department of the Financial Service Commission.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Henry. I'm representing also Vanuatu Financial Service Commission.
Morning, everyone. My name is Edmund. Representing Banks South Pacific.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Hanson, and I'm from the UAP team, TRR. Thank you.
Morning, everyone. My name is Tildra. I'm from OHCL.
Hi, everybody. I'm Clay Aiken from APNEC.
And good morning, everyone. My name is Barry Braley. I'm from the Domain Name Commission in .nz in New Zealand.
Good morning, everyone. Roger from Regulatory Service.
Okay. Thank you, everyone. We will now have our opening remarks from the regulator of telecommunications and radio communications. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Andrew, and welcome to you all who are around. First of all, I have to thank you sincerely for making your time and coming to Havana. And why Havana before I go to further remarks? Havana because it has proven to us that being away from town and being away from workplace, it has assisted to be, you know, concentrated on, you know, the subject matter. And also because of the experience that we have so far in a number of our conferences in Port Vila, we realized that, you know, towards the end of midday, there is no more people in the room. So we believe that, you know, and we have experienced that last year as well. So we thought it's, you know, we might as well maintain that to be away and have everybody in the room to contribute with their views and especially to the subject matter that we want to discuss. So once more, I thank you sincerely for taking up the time to be here. So basically, this forum is a build-up of what had happened so far. And it's, you know, a continuation of our awareness in terms of internet governance in Vanuatu. But most importantly, is preparing for the 98% coverage that will take place on January 1, 2018. And the coverage would be broadband. It's 98% of population coverage on broadband and voice. So by now, as we speak, some of the sites are already upgraded to 3G, and that's by TVL and Digicel. And we do believe that some people out there in Vanuatu, outside Port Vila and Luganville, are already online. And some of them, I have seen and experienced, that are actually online at, you know, in their homes and gardens. And that's very impressive. But at the same time, it's whether they are online safely. So that's our most concern, and which is why we think this session is very important to target security being and building from what had happened so far. So from last year, it was on net neutrality. And then we realized, okay, there are some sites are already upgraded to 3G. We might as well tap into security, and which is the subject matter that is, you know, very important, not just in Vanuatu and the region, but also globally. So once again, we welcome you, Barry and Clay, for accepting our invitation. And it's very valuable to have you here, given that it's just for a day. And your trip for a day is very important to us, and we believe by having all the colleagues in here and the team around who are also experts at their own areas will be assisting a lot on what is the main framework that we should be putting in place for the people of Vanuatu in the next coming months, and that is basically why we are here. So thank you everyone and enjoy the day.
Thank you very much, regulator, for those remarks. And we will proceed on to our first session. And we thank Barry from .nz. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Andrew, and good morning again, everyone. I suppose, firstly, thank you for conducting the sessions today in English. I would be struggling otherwise, I must admit. So if I do talk a little bit too fast, please interrupt me, ask me to repeat something. And that's, I'm on a few things today, so if that occurs at any point. Also, feel free to ask me questions at any time. Just put your hand up and interrupt me, and I'll take the questions as we go along. So I know we've introduced ourselves, so just to recover it. So I work in the Domain Name Commission in New Zealand, so as part of the regulator for the .nz top-level domain. We're actually owned by a charity called Internet NZ, so we're part of the Internet NZ group. And I also work some of my time on Internet NZ issues, so covering some of the broader security issues that New Zealand faces. I'm basically a security guy, so I've had security roles with the government and the private sector prior to working with the Internet NZ group. I chair a society of security professionals in New Zealand, which is quite an operational group. And we've got about 280 members across New Zealand and elsewhere in the world. And it's a fairly active society. And also, coming up next month as well, I'm also a founding member and a board member of the Information Security Awards for New Zealand, which is a scheme that we started 2 or 3 years ago. So, yeah, pretty much from a security background. So before we talk, obviously a little bit of what I'm going to cover when I'm talking about social media and internet security is a bit negative. It could be a scare you kind of topic. So I thought it would be important to caveat that I do think social media is a good thing, but there are some challenges. So in New Zealand, we probably encourage the use of social media. We think it provides a voice for people that otherwise might struggle to be heard. They're more comfortable with their interaction via social media. It also potentially extends discussions about important issues. So instead of the discussion just taking place in one room, through the use of the internet and social media, that discussion can reach out to other parts of the community that might not otherwise be engaged. Most importantly, I suppose, it helps with that interaction with family and friends, and so it can actually have a positive effect on the things that actually make society a better place. And generally, it exposes people to new ideas and fresh thinking and understanding about other cultures and societies, so it broadens horizons. But as is common on most things that I talk about to do with the internet that I say are very good, obviously there are always downsides. If you can have an open and free internet, then there are going to be negative impacts to that. And so I'll touch about some of that we see from a New Zealand perspective. So when Andrew asked me to talk for a few minutes on this, I was thinking about the social media in itself, and I kind of go back, probably only going to go back about 10 years in New Zealand on social media. So 10 years ago when I was first working in New Zealand, actually having emigrated there, obviously MySpace was still actually in use. You struggle to find someone that can even remember MySpace anymore. Right? So MySpace was kicking around. Facebook was becoming extremely popular 10 years ago. It was getting through certainly in the technology sectors of society. And the young people were using something called Bebo, which was like a Facebook site, but more targeted at young people. I don't know if you were exposed to those. So it was starting to be widely used. And really, 10 years ago, industry, government, and society as a whole, whilst we were trying to understand how we could better use social media and take advantage of it, we were also starting to identify that this has issues. There's people now sat inside our company on our corporate network, and they're constantly communicating through all of these channels that we previously hadn't allowed for. And these things are all designed to work over the standard internet connection, so it's not a different protocol or a different application that we can control. If they've got a browser, they can get to this. So it was starting to throw up these kind of issues. And the biggest issue that we were seeing in the early days, and it still goes on today, was around the kind of real world crime happening because of the information that you're exposing on the internet. And so this is actually a recent story, but that whole, I did it when I arrived at my hotel, I did a check-in on Facebook. And so obviously people realized that I was traveling for work because I said so, but so they won't go and burgle my house because hopefully they'll realize my wife's there, so I hope they don't. But people do, right? You go on holiday, they arrive at their resort or their destination, they check in, and hey, looking forward to 2 weeks of sun. And depending on how that their social media presence, how they've set it up and managed, potentially thousands of people now know exactly where that individual is, and they know they're away for 2 weeks. And if they know a little bit about them, like where they live, which they can probably also get from the photographs that they've shared standing outside of their house, suddenly it's quite simple to obviously hit into that. So that's not an internet security thing, but it does tie into some of the other points. So what I've seen as well over the last 10 years especially, and I'm going to talk a little bit more about this, is the rise of social engineering. So social engineering has been around for years. It's the tricks that a con man might use to persuade you to do something that otherwise you wouldn't necessarily do. And if they understand a little bit about you, then those tricks are easy to do. But because of all of the information that we as a society, especially certainly in New Zealand, actually expose online through social media, that social engineering is easier. And you can almost automate it. So you can stand up bots that will help you identify all of these things about people now. It's not even a complex activity. So social engineering and online cybercrime activity has really profited significantly from social media. So we shoot forward from that journey back to 10 years ago. What we're seeing, certainly in New Zealand, is that social media is obviously a treasure trove of information. I've just touched on it. We happily share, and I'll talk about some of the other information that we share in the second point I'm going to talk to in a little while. The information and the data is all out there. People have decided to expose it in this way. And that information can be utilized by many parties. The tech giants, the people that actually own these social media platforms, they utilize that data that we share. I'll talk about that a little bit later on. Obviously, marketing, again, largely related to those tech giants. Governments can use it. So the New Zealand government is a proactive user of social media. It sees it as a way that it can and should engage with society because we're moving towards we have a vision of a hyper-connected society. So we want to use social media. Of course, as we saw with some of the Edward Snowden revelations and some of the issues around the National Security Agency and some of those intrusive programs, governments can also make great use of social media for all of the wrong reasons. They could potentially make use of that social media activity to look at their own citizen base, and we're not huge fans of that, but the use is there. But the biggest thing that we'll see, and I'm going to use a couple of local examples that we see frequently in New Zealand, is that social engineering and cyber criminals. This is the biggest internet security issue that we certainly see in NZ. So there's three kind of key areas, or some key areas that we've seen. So one of the things that we started to see involving well-known, publicly recognizable people in New Zealand and around online activist groups like Anonymous. These well-known people have exposed a whole raft of their information about their personal life through social media, and then there's also all of the stuff that's actually documented about them. So if they're famous, they'll probably have a page on Wikipedia, there's going to be an About Us page if they're a senior person in an organization. So there's lots of this information out there, and what we started to see is that, in this instance, the group like Anonymous could actually use that information to successfully answer the security questions that person has around, in this case, or for instance, I'm thinking of, their social media account. So they hijacked, they'll hijack a famous person's Twitter account and start to broadcast information via Twitter as this said well-known person, and they'll potentially make racist comments or sexist comments or stuff that's actually offensive and rude. Which obviously damages the reputation of the person. They can also use the same tricks to bypass the security questions and socially engineer access so that they can hijack the person's email account. not only will they be able to see all of the emails that that person has had that are stored in that on, in their email system, they're also then able to engage as that person with other people, and potentially that we've even seen them lead on to using those security questions to get around some of the controls when you phone up the bank. So obviously telephone banking as a backup to internet banking is quite common, and normally those standard security questions are the ways that we see that. So we've seen that ongoing for the last few years. And then more recently, we've seen a real spike, especially this year. Phishing and other scammers have effectively changed their activities. So certain crime groups originating from specific parts of the world have used technical measures traditionally, especially around banking-related data. So they've relied on malicious software to infect people's machines that then gets their banking data. However, because of a scam that I'm going to talk about, a CFO scam, that's turned out to be so much more lucrative, we've seen those criminal groups switch their main effort of activity to less technical approaches where they can just use social media and social engineering to make tens of thousands of dollars, whereas before they were perhaps only making a few thousand per attack. And then the other thing that we've seen over the last 2 years to a real heavy, and it probably leads on to the CEO, CFO thing, is that fake social media accounts, especially on LinkedIn. And so these fake LinkedIn accounts, they started off, they were all, in fact, I've got it on the next slide, so there was a real rap for this, and it still goes on. So they're all attractive people. They will probably be attractive to the other sex, opposite sex. A lot of them are from recruitment companies, or they just say, hey, I was checking out your profile, thought we should connect. And these aren't, they're not even being run by actual people. So you can program a bot to do all of this for you once you set up the basics. So you identify a few details, and then you let it loose on LinkedIn, and it goes off, and it creates hundreds and hundreds of connections with people. And so I used it as a check where these started to come into my inbox, and then I was trying to figure out how they'd got to me, and obviously they'd got to me through one of my LinkedIn contacts. And so that's almost a right. I trust that person less than I used to trust them, because they've clearly just accepted a connection from a bot, right? Not even a real person. And quite possibly because the picture appealed to them. So we saw this. What I've seen in the last year or so, and I'd have had to create a completely fake profile to show you. So off the back of this, where they were going after whole sectors of industry professionals, especially through the tech industry, it seemed, they then realized that they could use the same thing with large corporates. So they create a fake LinkedIn account for a very senior manager, like a chief executive level or the next tier of management down within a large company. And then they use that, and they basically enumerate every employee of that company, because what employee that works, say if it's a bank, for example, the branch manager of a bank, if the hot country manager of the bank wants to connect to him on LinkedIn, he's going to accept, right? The picture's right, the name's right, so he connects. And so suddenly the cyber criminals have now got the LinkedIn and email contact details for an entire corporation within a country. So we saw them use that as a ploy, which they can then use for other things down the track once they've built up this database of attacks. And so started late last year, and it got to epic proportions in New Zealand earlier this year. I'm just calling it the CEO CFO scam. This one was quite close to home for us. It wasn't successful, but I've still blanked out the details to so as not to embarrass anyone. So here we have a chief executive of a company, and he's enjoying his holiday in Paris. And this was one of many tweets that he'd made, all about his like great food that he just ate on the Champs-Élysées, etc. And this was a picture of his morning walk, and that's the Palace of Versailles that he's looking at through the trees. And so on Twitter, he's a technologist, he's a proactive Twitter user, he likes to use Twitter and encourages people to do it. But he obviously lives his life in this very vicarious kind of Twitter-like way and shares excessively with everyone. If I sound negative about Twitter, I'm not. I personally don't use Twitter, but yeah. So he shares everything on this, and this arrives on a specific day in January when he's enjoying his holiday. And I mocked up this email, but I have got the header to prove how quick it was. I didn't have the actual email. The chief financial officer of the same organization gets this email 12 hours later. And this was real common of the text that they're using. It's normally a real quick, like short title, like request or need your help or this is urgent. And then it says, hi, whatever. Sometimes there's not even a name, just hi. And it comes from, they'll use the name of the chief executive, but they've actually mocked it up in a various different types of webmail type services. So all of those new top-level domains, the GTLDs that have come online, obviously webmail services through all of those, so they masked it up. So it comes up saying that the actual CEO's name, they know who the chief financial officer is, again, because of their like harvesting through social media, they've identified all this. And then it's a real quick, hey, are you busy? And what we saw a lot of is they take advantage of knowing something about where the chief executive is when they know he's overseas. So I was just talking to someone in Paris. We've got a real opportunity, but we're going to need to move fast. If you can help us move the money quickly, email me back. And they do it deliberately short like that so to get the CFO engaged. And they find that if the chief financial officer replies, that's the point at which they'll go into the more detail. So they don't want to put out too much in the first instance. It's quite short. And then if they get that reply email, they know that they're 50% of the way there to cashing out on this particular one. So they go through this. On this instance, and I know the people involved, the reason this wasn't successful is because there was no Happy New Year or hope you had a good break. This was the first email that he sent to the CFO after the Christmas holidays. And so the CFO's like, as in New Zealand, it's normally common for all of January, pretty much. If it's the first time you interact with someone, you always open with a Happy New Year or hope you had a great holiday. And that was the thing that alerted the CFO to the fact that this is weird, and mostly because the CFO was a bit riled. And then when they looked, they're like, this is not the chief executive. So that one was unsuccessful purely because of that. Who knows if they'd known that little one sentence that would have got them over the line, could have gone a different way. There's been others that would have been successful if organizations didn't have financial controls in place that required a second set of eyes before a new payment is made to a receiver. So these are some of the ones that have made the public news. These are just a sampling of some of the losses we saw. So these are from the tail end of 2015. The fire service of New Zealand fell for this exact ploy in a different context, $50,000 New Zealand. And an education organization, the bottom one, I think that was 120 or 130,000. They did exactly the same. It was a geographical trick. One of the senior deans was overseas at the time, and they sent in the email saying, just been speaking to these people. For the bottom one, the financial officer of that organization was fired as a result of this loss because they felt it was unfair. So those two losses alone are $180,000, $170,000 New Zealand in just two cases, and those are two of the more public ones that I can talk about. There are hundreds more in New Zealand alone. So this has been a huge thing for the last 12 months in NZ. People have just started to become wise to it, seeing less of it. But yeah, it is all built off of all that information that the bad guys can harvest off of their social media and other sources. That was all I was going to touch on for social media and internet security. Andrew's asked me to talk a little bit about privacy in a little bit. Are there any questions on any of that before I pass on to someone else to speak?
Thank you, Barry. For questions, please, you just say your name because we have some followers online, so they know who is talking. Thank you. Thank you, Barry. Let's give him a round of applause. Okay. Our next session is on Facebook challenges in Vanuatu, and we'll ask Jackson to present that for us. Thank you, Jackson.
Thank you, Andrew, and good morning to us all. Clay, welcome to Vanuatu, as well as Barry. I think we met in Apricot early this year. And and also to the rest of us, good morning. I'm presenting on behalf of our office, Office of the Government Chief Information Officer, just to give an overview on the challenges that we are working on, specifically for Facebook. So my presentation is quite short. I'll give briefly a background on what it is that we're doing in the whole sector, and also challenges and our plans, especially around this area on Facebook and social media issues. Okay, just to give an overview, this background, all this information was sourced from PRR's website. Firstly, 10 years ago, there was only one operator, and today we have approximately 8 operators in Vanuatu. 10 years ago, we didn't have any policies on ICT development, cyber security, and also universal access, which a lot of operators are currently undertaking. Regulations, we didn't have any 10 years ago. Access was very limited, for only 16% to approximately 92% as we speak. Connectivity was also very limited, about 2 meg for the whole country, to approximately over 20 gigs as we speak. Internet was only 1%, and I'm sure a few of us would still recall those annoying sounds from the modems for dial-up. To now we have 3.5G and some have moved on to LTE. Mobile subscription also has quadrupled, I think, from 21,000 to now just over 180,000 people have access to a mobile. GDP, again, there's a lot of growth in this area, about 5.3%. The cost also for telephone services 10 years ago was very high, and I am sure a lot of us just finishing school then didn't have any mobile. It was only available as postpaid, and you couldn't text on prepaid. And to now, it's widely available. You can get a SIM for 500 Fatu. And also, since the arrival of the submarine cable, there's been a huge drop in terms of prices. E-government, we didn't have any infrastructure. And now we're talking about e-services, which also covers social media. Okay, so for connecting people, as most of us would be aware, thanks to TRR and also the cooperation of our operators, we are working to achieve this goal by 2018 to connect 98% of our population to broadband internet with bandwidth specifications at 21 meg downlink and 12 meg uplink. And I understand we have come up to some compromise on this, mainly for given the cyclone last year and a few other issues. And we're using a pay-or-play approach, thanks to the operators who have committed themselves to achieve this goal. We're working to give out tablets, also broadband for schools, telemedicine, digital TV, e-applications, also free Facebook for users on internet, and a few other events, which also includes this event, specifically on internet governance. So the role of social media in government is quite important. More and more citizens are going online. They're actively talking about tax, for example, that was only introduced earlier this month. The discussions, consultations are going on. People are reading, they're engaging. and they're voicing their opinions on policy changes done by the government, and it has made participation to development now widely available to almost everyone with access to internet. Talking about a few years' time, imagine just sending a tweet to, for example, Minister Chodam Napata, the Minister of Infrastructure. He's quite active. He's out there repairing roads. And imagine in 5 years, you just send him a tweet that, I live out in Freshwater, for example, and we have a pothole. Can someone come and fix it? And within, let's say, 5 hours, the public works are there, fixing the roads, etc. But I'm sure we're just dreaming, because you're all smiling. But anyways, those are some of the things you would expect. We get a lot of pressure from comments coming out from social media. And as government, our role is to ensure that people are happy. And a lot of times, most of this information are sourced from social media. So our role in social media, the government, we have a very challenging role. Our role is to ensure that people use social media safely and wisely, and ensure their safety is paramount at all times throughout Vanuatu. And also, multi-stakeholder approach is very important. We can't take the case of Nauru, close down Facebook just because someone posted some nasty local materials online, and we take a stand to close Facebook and get letters. For example, Barack Obama even wrote to the government to turn on Facebook, because Facebook is based out of San Francisco in the US. It's a US company, and we have all these other political problems associated. So as a responsible government, our role at all times is to ensure we have a good relationship with operators, with users, to ensure that whatever we do, either to regulate the internet, the content, or whatever, we all agree on whatever direction it is that we intend to take. Also, in terms of capacity building, there's a lot of work to be done around this area, especially in Vanuatu, where a few years ago, a survey carried out showed that only 27% of our people are able to read, write, and speak English, Bislama, or French. So that's another challenge. Even it's obvious, you go on Facebook, and some of the things people type, all the whatever, you don't even know what they're talking about. But these are some of the issues that we need to tackle as a government. Not only in ICT, also in education, we need to work with them to ensure that students are able to read, write, and understand whatever it is they're doing. And of course, our participation in international meetings to exchange, learn, and get information on how to tackle social media issues. Okay, just to give a few cases that our office has dealt with, the police most recently. The common one is fake accounts. I think Barry has talked about this in his slides. But we have people even pretending to be prime minister. This, since Facebook became famous a few years ago in Vanuatu, we've had a few cases of people impersonating prime minister. The first was I think Honorable Moana a few years ago, and there was a case on Sato Kilman when he was Prime Minister, and he did exactly what Barry was talking about. He's also active on social media. Someone picked it up, sent a fake email for people to send him money, but unfortunately that didn't happen. The other one is on online defamation. Most of us going on Facebook, you would notice that there's a lot of things around defamation that's happening. Unfortunately, at this stage, we can't do anything because we do not have any cybercrime bill to tackle these issues. However, are we happy to say that the new cybercrime bill is currently listed for the upcoming sitting of parliament, and we are hopeful that once this passes, we will be able to deal with a lot of these issues. The other one is on money laundering. Again, it relates to fake accounts, people sending money. The last report we got from the Financial Intelligence Unit, there was quite a lot of money sent out last year. It was close to 40 million. So 40 million fatu that people sent out. And it's not only for someone out in the rural, it also happens to people who are working. They are aware of all these issues, and yet they send off money overseas. Stalking, bullying, and solicitation of children. This survey some years back with PRR and the International Telecoms Union has identified that there's actually cyberbullying, also stalking that's happening to our children, especially in schools. And the only source of cybersecurity awareness that most of the students get is from schools. The programs that are conducted by the Crime Prevention Unit, the police, most of the students get their information from there. And the most recently, in the past few weeks and months, we've been dealing with a lot of local porn issues. Again, similar to defamation and other cases, we're dealing directly with Facebook to take down all these issues. So again, once the bill comes into play, we'll be in a better position to tackle cyber crime issues. Our plans, firstly, is to have this bill passed in Parliament next month or the month after. And also, one of the outstanding plans is the establishment of a CERT. It's been outstanding since 2014, and it's mainly due to financial resources from outside. Law enforcement, again, we need to work very closely with the police, customs, immigration, and border to make sure that to try. We can't be 100% sure, but at least to work to cut down on all these cybercrime issues that are happening between the borders. It's quite difficult. Again, someone can be in Africa or can be in Asia and doing stuff to someone in Vanuatu, which is quite difficult. Hence, we need our international cooperation to tackle such issues. Consumer awareness, as we've been doing for the past few years. Engagement at schools with our school connectivity programs. We need to tell students to be cyber smart and also to be responsible users, especially on Facebook. And again, as always, we'd like to be open, transparent, and accountable for all our actions and other things on the internet. So I think that's it for my presentation on this part. And if there's no questions, then I'll proceed to the next presentation.
Thank you. I'm Frederick. Thank you, Jackson. I was particularly interested in, you mentioned that some of the reported cases that we had, especially with regards to Facebook, social media. We've had two prime ministers, some people created fake accounts under to one current prime minister and maybe one former prime minister. Also, the previous speaker touched on these issues with social media, and I think he mentioned a little that backless or probably criminal syndicates who are using Facebook to steal information or to carry out any criminal activities, they could actually not only, I take it that they do not only create fake accounts, but they could actually access your email information from those accounts. And thereby, they could actually have access to, say, confidential information. If because we understand that a lot of people in government now are involved with social media, are forming groups within the social media to disseminate information, because it's otherwise it's readily accessible to a lot of people who are using it nowadays. So my question is, if we have a situation whereby someone is able to not only create a fake account, but actually infiltrate into the email itself and have this probably access to, say, confidential government information. If we have a situation like this, my question is, how secured are the government email systems? Not only within the government, but the government agencies. Is it the same, the risks the same as with regards to social media, Twitter, Facebook? I mean, we have measures in place. At the end of the day, we'll have what you mentioned, that the government is looking at introducing a cybercrime bill. And that cybercrime bill will come to punish those who have broken the law. But at this point in time, while we are doing this, we are discussing these issues, security issues, how secure is the government email system anyway? Are we working on making it more secure? I think that's my question. It was very interesting that we've had this case in New Zealand, and you mentioned that we actually had two cases with people actually creating fake accounts for our prime ministers, one former and the current one. Thank you.
Thank you, Frederick. I think thank you for your question. I think for the first part on illegal access, I think I'll talk about that more in my next presentation when I cover the cybercrime bill. But in terms of the security of the government broadband network, we have our two staff here, there's Jethro and Felix. Maybe they'll assist if I miss out on anything. But our network is very secured. We do have measures in place, technologies, up-to-date technologies, and we also working with international partners to make sure security for our system is paramount at all times. Like any network, we take security very seriously, especially that our network hosts a lot of confidential government information, and our role is to ensure that this information doesn't get into people's hands that they may use to maybe blackmail us or something along the lines. However, we've had cases in the past where government employees, for instance, upload confidential government documents on Facebook or on other social media platforms. That has caused quite a lot of irritation among the larger citizens. In this case, I guess our best way to tackle it will be through this cybercrime bill, which talks about access as well as disclosure of information. If I missed anything, maybe Jethro can assist to elaborate more on security.
Thank you. Yes, we do have security mechanisms in place to safeguard the users, our users, particularly the Vanguard users. And as such, there will always be some users who would want to do some go it their own way, I guess. And regarding Facebook, As you know, the policy for the government is to limit or restrict Facebook for employees within the network, and only certain users have privilege to access Facebook. However, we do have a control system in place where we can monitor what our users are doing online, that we, our users are aware of that, that the traffic is not, that it, we have the ability to monitor the traffic and as such to control what they're doing online, just to ensure that they do not misuse the privilege that they have. And regarding the hacked Facebook accounts or the fake accounts that were created for the prime ministers, it is something that is beyond our control. Someone out there can just collect the information about the current prime minister and then create the fake accounts. And so in a number of cases, our office has to deal with Facebook directly to try to identify the source. And so that is the one good thing about our relationship that we have with Facebook, and that if there's an issue that arises, which is of national interest, then you can talk to your Facebook directly, and then Facebook can assist us, especially to track down the user or to take down what was posted online. I think that is what I can
Just going on, Jackson, and I suppose I know you talk directly with Facebook in regards to those users that have got fake accounts. But have you looked at the verification of accounts as well? So people like MPs that are on Facebook and that have their accounts verified. I know when I last tried to look at verification, you couldn't do it in Vanuatu. Okay, so have you approached them in regards to allowing you to actually do a verification so that the people do know that that account that's there has been verified by Facebook as being appropriate to that person who's using it?
Thank you, Brad. In the current practice that we do, we usually just check with actual user themselves. Like, for instance, in the current Prime Minister's case, he had 6 Facebook accounts, and he confirmed that he doesn't own any of them. So we notified Facebook and they took it down, as well as working with their partners to take down the cached profiles on the other servers around. However, for the verification, we haven't looked at that option, but it's something that we could take up with Facebook so that we ensure our MPs and other users are more aware.
It would be good now that we seem to have a lot more MPs and DGs and things like that on Facebook, okay? Just to ensure that they're safe now that they're actually online and using it in a way that is not only social but also back into the community and the governing of the country.
Thanks. Okay, if there's no more questions, I'll move on to my next presentation. Sorry for boring you guys, but we are in Havana, so I'm sure everything is okay. Okay, thanks again. My next presentation will be on the cybercrime legislation. That has we've been working on for a few years as part of a regional project funded by the International Telecoms Union and the Australian government to develop cybersecurity policies as well as cybercrime legislations. So we've, with the assistance of the International Telecoms Union, we've managed to form a local working group comprising of law enforcement agencies such as police, customs, TRR, and OGCIO to come up with
what is I will be presenting. So our policy programs were approved by the government in 2013, and the policy goals is to develop organization structures. This includes setting up a CERT. The other one is on standardization and services, strengthening legal framework, which I will go more into detail in this presentation, capacity building and international cooperation. As we know, for international cooperation, it's quite important, given we lack cybercrime experts locally, so we rely a lot on our international partners, such as the partnership that the police have with AFP and AFP with Interpol, given that Vanuatu is not a member of Interpol, but we hope to be part of them in the future. Cybersecurity initiatives, we had the first child online protection workshop a few years ago, and we developed a framework which we are currently working with the Ministry of Justice to implement. So the outcome of that report, as part of compiling that report, we did a survey at Central School, and we found that of the 234 students we surveyed, 90% use the internet. This was 4 years ago. I'm sure it has increased. 30 use the internet daily, 50% use Facebook, etc. So you can read the numbers yourselves. Interestingly, only 21% use antivirus, which is the first step to making sure your device is secured. One out of three learn about cybersecurity in schools, etc. And the final point is one out of three try to hack into a wireless network, so that's quite interesting as well. Coming up with the legal framework. Okay, this bill is currently, I'll just give a summary of all the offenses under this draft bill. First is illegal access. That's relates to what Frederick asked previously. So again, if you illegally access any computer system or network, you are liable for these fines and penalties. The other one is illegal remaining. This relates to, for instance, someone giving access to a particular person to use their computer for, let's say, 1 hour, and that person stays on the computer for 2 hours, and in the time of that extra time, they might have extracted some confidential information or accessed files that they were not supposed to file access. Sorry, they have also fines and penalties up to this amount. The other one is illegal interception. This relates to tapping into calls between entities or between individuals. It also has fines for this one. Also, illegal interference. Someone is putting up some sort of device and you continuously interfere. For illegal interference, this relates to putting up device without getting approval from regulator. So, found a few cases where people are putting up devices in areas around town, and as a result, they interfere with whatever systems around them. Data espionage, again, this is about giving out confidential company or government data to people. System interference, illegal device is also quite important. We've had a few, let's say, not so genuine devices that have been sold in our local market. And this particular section, provision, targets those, especially our shops. We would like to get rid of all these illegal devices. Not only they're illegal, but sometimes they're not properly checked, and they may cause hazard to users. Another offense is relating to forgery. If you use a computer or any device to commit a forgery, to forge, let's say, a check or something like that, you are also liable to be fined. The other is on fraud. Fraud is quite common. It's also covered under the bill, child pornography. And pornography are also covered. And this specifically mentions text, even if it's just a text, or just audio, sound, or videos. I think in the past we've noticed that in some cybercrime bills, it doesn't mention sound. There's some sick people out there who only capture sound, so we've also covered this under the new law. Identity-related crime, again, it relates to what we've been talking about this morning. If you try to impersonate someone or pretend you're someone, you also can be fined under the new law. Spam. Spamming, if we identify spam coming out of any particular machines or networks, you can also be fined or penalized. The other one is on disclosure of information. In the event where a court warrant is served to an individual or a corporation to give information for relating to any crimes and someone is trying to interfere, or they give out that information to people they're not supposed to give out, you can also be liable for that. The other one is cyberstalking. Again, if you follow someone around on the internet, you can also be fined. Solicitation of children. We've had a few cases where, I think the last one was a few months ago, of someone going up in Torres, and he was trying to take pictures of children, etc. That is also, we can also penalize those people. Unfortunately, he got away because we don't have such, we don't cover this in any deals. Defamation is also covered. So again, just to make sure people are mindful that whatever they're saying online, they can be prosecuted. Religious offense, this relates to, we've had a few cases where people from a denomination talk against people from another denomination or from another religious group. We can also fine people for that. Aiding and abetting, that's also covered. So, yes. And then no more. Thank you.
Thank you, Jackson. Just curious, so within the what you're putting forward in this framework, what we see in New Zealand is a lot of the, whilst we have a lot of local victims, I'm talking about those losses, obviously the perpetrators, the criminals, are overseas. Those criminals invariably are probably in developing economies. Obviously, some of this is quite easy. So within your legislation, the punishments are there. Would those punishments still apply if the criminal is in Vanuatu, but the victim is overseas and you're receiving the report from a partner or overseas police force? Would that still apply?
Thank you, Barry. I think that will still apply, depending on how multilateral or bilateral arrangements with whichever jurisdictions, but we would also like to cover that in this bill.
Hello, speaking. Just one question. The due date for this bill, you will present it directly to Parliament, or it's only a draft?
Thank you. It will be presented to Parliament in December, next sitting of Parliament.
Okay, because I already read it and I have some concern regarding this bill, because, for example, for a lot of parts,
you are making a difference between public and
fines and bills were aligned with the current existing laws. So we didn't want to differentiate the fines and penalties, for example, on what's covered under the penal code or what's already covered under other laws. So thank you for your feedback. We're still getting making changes until the end of this month. So we do note that part, and we will notify our legal counterparts to most probably incorporate that, those changes.
Thank you, Jackson. Sorry, me again. Maybe I'll just want to add on to the query that was raised by our colleague up front. We do have other legislations that would fall in well with this proposed bill with regards to mutual assistance in criminal matters. And yes, we have arrangements in place with other countries whereby we could assist with extradition requests or and whatnot. And maybe I'll just add on to, we do have, because we are a regulator and a supervisor at the VFSC, and we, since it's in a bill status, but we do have, because of course you cannot send a corporate body into jail, but the legislations are drafted in such a way that if you are a corporate body, then you pay a fine. But if you are an individual, you could pay a fine or both, in a fine and imprisonment. This is what our experience with our clients. So I'm sure when it is drafted with regards to individuals, it would be the individual could pay a fine or go to imprison or both, and a corporate body, of course, a fine. Anyway, it's just a comment. I noted some of the penalties and fines that you mentioned, and I think we. I know that cybercrime could actually, as you've mentioned, ruin the person's reputation or actually destroy a company. I was just wondering if you could actually increase the penalties, 2 million or 5 years imprisonment, and make it because it is something that you could actually lose everything and your company and everything. Zero. Thank you.
Thank you, Frederick. In fact, when we first had a first draft, the fines and imprisonment terms were set very high. However, we were advised to lower those so they again align with, for example, penal code and other laws. Otherwise, you'll see a cybercrime law here with penalties that are very high. Whereas, for example, the penal code will have things relating to like stalking or theft with penalties and imprisonment terms that are quite low. So that's why we had it as it is. But again, the changes may happen only, for instance, if we review the penal code and then we're able to also make changes or amendments to both. Yeah.
Thanks, Jackson, for the presentation. Just on cybercrime, in terms of online fraud or system hacking, this more on country or sovereign risk issues. If the criminal resides in one of the trade sanctioned countries, how successful in terms of cybercrime law enforcement would exercise those people to be tried in the country?
Okay, thank you for your question. I think it relates to what Barry's question. It will relate a lot to whatever jurisdiction arrangements we have with other countries. Unfortunately, the first thing is I'm not a lawyer. I'm just working on this bill, but I'm sure there are frameworks in place where we can work to
extradite people to here or otherwise out of Vanuatu. The other thing to note is we may be working to develop a privacy bill in the future, and this relates more to containing information about citizens of Vanuatu, only within Vanuatu. At the moment, there are few companies and institutions that have, for example, customer information that are stored outside. We would like to have that all stored within country, mainly for such security reasons, and also to assist with our cybercrime activities.
Firstly, thank you for the presentation. Just looking at the, you put the sentences on the Cybercrime Act. Just a question of if they use the internet or the Facebook to put a false alarm or threat, will that act cover that? The other part is in response to the question asked by my colleague there, we have currently have number of money laundering cases that we're currently working with the financial intelligence unit and also the Attorney General Service. Yeah, we still have some gaps. We are working on the money laundering and the transactions of funds from different banks or institutions to others. Apparently, we still have a shortfall on the use of internet and transfer. So maybe the current Cybercrime Act will cover that.
Okay. Thank you for that question. I think we will take the alarm, we'll discuss more on the alarm part. I didn't quite get your question, but we can discuss that further. And yes, in terms of capturing these cyber criminals, of course, it's quite difficult. As we know, currently, for all our anything to do with enforcement, police is always our first point of contact. To be aligned with, for instance, filing a complaint and other things. And we would like to still keep that as part of these cybercrime activities to ensure that people can always go to the police as the first line of reporting cybercrime activities. But it's always difficult, given we lack human resources in this area. But hopefully, with the establishment of, for instance, CERT, we are able to identify people from police, maybe from the private sector, who are able to work with our cybercrime activities.
Balen from TVL. Yes, I think thank you for your presentation. Here you have presented a bit more on the fine and the fines and prisoners. That's good. But we just want to know what is the implication for the all stakeholders, I mean the telecom operators, ISPs, in this law. Can we have a summary, what would be the implication on that?
Thanks, Balen. I will forward a copy of this draft bill. It covers, there's a lot more explanation on operators and corporations, and big companies in each of the provisions under this bill. So. But it does cover a few sections in the provisions, covers issues relating to companies and corporations. Yeah.
Thank you, Jackson. Just hold on. There's one question from our online viewers. And it relates to the previous presentation. And it says, what other things or mediums can help you sell internet packages other than Facebook?
And the comments he said, looks like most marketing campaigns use Facebook to sell internet packages, so they must be prepared to meet the challenges. I don't know whether that's directed to you. That's from Glennis Fora online.
Okay, thank you for this question. I think it relates more to marketing. Of course, we all want to market our services, and social media is a platform whereby a lot of users online, especially that it's free, especially in Vanuatu, and people do get a lot of information from Facebook. I'm sure we all have families living out in rural areas, and here you are thinking you've come from the city and you know everything, and you find a lot of interesting things talked of by these people. So they are aware of whatever it is that we're doing. And yes, a lot of local companies use Facebook as a media for marketing, and unfortunately we have nothing against such activities. It's all, you can always disable such updates or notifications on the privacy tab on your Facebook account. So you can opt to not receive such notifications on your profile, and every time that comes up, you won't be able to get it.
Okay, let's thank Jackson for being there for two presentations. Give him a big hand, of course. You're off the hook now. Okay, we have two more presentations before we have a break. I'll let Barry continue with his last session. And this is on privacy issues, so it'll be interesting. Thank you, Barry. Just again on some housekeeping while Barry is getting on. We do have internet Wi-Fi here, and if you need the password, see Choi Lin right there at the back there during the break to get a password. And yes, just don't overload the traffic. We are streaming live, so we need just use it for emails. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Andrew, and thanks again, Jackson. That was interesting. I was intrigued to see that the cyber crime bill was on the agenda. I've got a bit of an interest in that. In New Zealand, we've actually, most of that's covered under our main crimes act, but there's some provisions in there for cybercrime. But we do have harmful digital communications bill, which is just coming to the completion of its effect. Happy to talk about that during the break. It's a little bit different. So Andrew also asked me to touch on social media and online privacy, some of which obviously related to the internet security topic that I was talking about earlier, but it's actually going to feed nicely into, because I'm probably going to talk a little bit more about the marketing aspects of some of these social media companies and how that affects our privacy in some ways. One of the great people that I like that talks about this quite a lot is a gentleman called Mikko Huppanen, who works for a company called F-Secure. He's a security researcher and speaker. If you're interested in these sorts of topics, I suggest you check out some of his talks on the internet. They're very interesting. But caveat again, I do use social media. I do think social media is a good thing. There's lots of things around the information that social media has about us which is quite useful, where allowing certain applications on your social media apps on your phone to use location services is convenient when you need to know where the nearest gas station is or something. But there are challenges. So the same caveats that I used earlier apply, although some of this could be a little bit negative. So when Andrew asked me to talk to this topic, I kind of thought about the questions that I have about online privacy in the context of the 21st century. And so four questions that I was thinking about, and I think, I've seen a lot of suggestion that privacy and online privacy are a myth. And so is privacy possible anymore, especially online privacy? Do people really care? Now, I talked earlier about some of the user behavior that's perhaps
foolish or risque in this nature, but do they really care? Is privacy still just about personally identifiable information? Or potentially is it broader, but is it still about that? And has it changed over the last few years or the last decade? And when I was thinking about those four questions, to me, the answer is yes on all counts, but there are challenges, and I'll talk to a couple of those challenges. So in terms of do people care, especially, not so much online privacy, but we had a few issues in New Zealand around privacy over the last two or three years with large government organisations and some private sector organisations having inadvertent leaks of personal information about citizens. And the backlash from the public in the kind of how unhappy or upset they are about this suggests that people do care. Whether people care enough to do something about their own behaviour online, I'm not sure. But people clearly still care about privacy. Privacy and security and openness are seen as three things that can coexist by most people. I don't sign up to the belief that you can't have security and privacy. I think that's not quite correct. It's up to us now, in the 21st century, to ensure that people have the ability to use the internet in an open way, but still have privacy and security. Certainly that's the way we got the internet a couple of decades ago, and now it's up to people to carry it on. One little side, when I'm thinking about some of these privacy issues that organisations have faced, I quite like to use that as an example of why it happens. So those large corporates had set up processes to prevent these things, but the processes weren't that simple or straightforward. And so the staff have obviously found ways to bypass foolish processes leading to those bad leaks. So in the context of New Zealand, we see, and this is not New Zealand specific, this is all over the place, people actually behave differently when they're using social media. And generally they behave slightly differently probably when they're using the internet, but especially on social media, we see that people's behavior changes. And occasionally that's because there's a psychologist test around anonymity, and if people believe they've got a protection of anonymity, then they behave a little bit more boorishly or in manners that they might not in their everyday life. And that's probably where some of those people say they value privacy, but then at the same time, when you go and look at their use of social media, they're exposing themselves quite drastically in their online presence. And so we as a society, both in New Zealand and globally, we still need to adjust and comprehend what that actually means. I think in the scheme of things, if you look at civilization for the last 4,000 years, the 20 or 30 years that we've had the internet in existence, well, actually longer, 40 or 50 years, but the last 10 to 20 years where we've actually had people using the internet in any sizable number are a tiny, tiny little speck on that kind of broad landscape of civilization. And so we're seeing some changes in society, both good and bad, and eventually we'll need to get to some kind of norms of behavior where people's accepted norms are the same in the real world as they are in their use of social media or online. Certainly, I would expect that to be in our current context, that would suggest that they're going to pull back slightly in how they behave on social media. But at the same time, and we see this a lot in New Zealand, our young people especially actually behave differently again. When we speak to young people about their use of social media, they seem to have less concerns about their personal privacy than perhaps their parents or slightly older people do. Now, their viewpoint might change as they go up, but it could be that society's actually going to move forward and be a little bit more open and less concerned about their privacy challenges. And I think that perception from young people has been driven by social media, which is just a viewpoint from mine. Again, they could change. It's all about society getting used to this phenomenon and agreeing on its norms to a great extent. The other thing, especially over the last 20 years, I suppose, with social media, when 20 years ago, when web browsers were first being developed, the clever people that we're designing those tools that we now use on a daily basis or even hourly basis to access the internet. They probably thought that content was going to be paid for in some micropayment scheme. So you want to read a news article on your favorite news site, and you click on the article, and that's automatically deducted half a cent from your account or something. That was probably like the notional idea that these people had when the internet was a fledgling thing. But the reality is quite different. The reality is that most of the stuff we consume on the internet is free, and it's because tech giants have found ways to commoditize the internet in other ways. Clever, but at the same time, they have commoditized it in other ways. And what they've technically commoditized are the people that use the internet, social media, and their platforms. And so some of the schemes that we see from some of those tech giants are potentially scarier in some ways than some of the stuff Edward Snowden was talking about a couple of years ago. So their ability to do this is pretty immense. And it's around people's perception of how they use the internet is how they're actually making their money. And if you're interested in this, I really suggest, and we talked about advertising content on these platforms, I suggest that you go and actually buy some advertising space on Twitter or one of those things. And there's a series of questions that you jump through when you buy it. And it's like, do you want to target males or females? And obviously Twitter probably knows what gender you are. Do you want to target people that live in this particular part of the country or the world or the region or this part? And what age groups, what employment types? And then as you get further and further down this question, it's like, do you want to target people that eat frosted Rice Krispies or Kellogg's cornflakes for breakfast? It's like, how does Twitter know what my breakfast cereal preference is? Do you want to target people that prefer orange juice or cranberry juice? And again, how does Twitter know these things? And it's because those social media tech giants have actually also spent a fortune buying aggregated data from other clearinghouses or other tech giants so that they can aggregate all of this together and build a better picture about you. And obviously then they make their money from selling that. So, well, I'm not saying the privacy is dead, it's just that people need to be aware that this is what's going on so that they can make conscious decisions when they are adjusting their privacy settings on Facebook or in how they even use it. So on a personal level, I use a couple of social media platforms, and I'm very specific on how I use those platforms. So for Facebook, for example, unless you're into the same sorts of vehicles as me, related to me, or went to school with me, I probably won't connect to you, whereas on LinkedIn, that's more for my people that I come into contact with in my professional capacity, and so I deliberately keep that segregation. I'm also cautious about all of the extra snippets of information, so your cell phone number as a point of recovery for any of those apps, I tend to not allow, just so I don't have to divulge that information to them. So, looking around online, this is what someone put up around. This is the stuff that the social media platforms already can get from you or other people using them, which I just copied it off. I went through it. I'm pretty sure that all of that stuff will be there. They might have to take it out in context of how you talked about stuff. So they already know all of these things about you, potentially, depending on your use of social media. And then, as I said, if they then go out and buy additional data sets with identifiers that they can cross-reference into this space, they can build up even more of a picture about you. Because obviously, at no point did I tell Facebook what I like to eat for breakfast. But there's a chance that they might think they know, and they're going to have a bash at it, because I might have posted a photo of my breakfast when I was on holiday somewhere or something, because it was particularly good. Okay, they're going to think that I eat yams and mangoes for breakfast because I was on a tropical island, whereas obviously I don't at home because we don't get them in the shops. But yeah, so this is all the stuff that's up there, and or potentially up there if people are using the social media in a less aware way. This is a Mikko Hipponen point that came up recently as well. So obviously they're buying all of this other data, they know a lot about you. And one of the interesting things around how they tie all that together is generally, the unique identifier that most of these companies like to use is still your cell phone number. So So your whatever your mobile phone number is their preferred unique identifier. And that's one of the reasons, potentially, personal theory, that's one of the reasons, potentially, why an application called WhatsApp was worth $19 billion to Facebook. Because Facebook previously didn't have a really good mechanism for finding out your cell phone number, but WhatsApp did. So they get thousands and thousands and thousands of cell phone numbers which they can then cross-reference and improve the quality of how they can sell that data to online advertisers. So it's worth $19 billion to them. It would have been more catastrophic if Facebook's competitors had bought WhatsApp as well, is the other reason for it. But it's because it's that unique identifier crossover thing. Sadly, in the modern world, or maybe not sadly, I mean, the internet is what the internet is. We can change it. You talk about as a country, you could decide to stand up your own social media platform that works better for your citizens. You don't have to use these things. But if your citizens want to talk to friends in America or New Zealand, then they're probably going to end up back on these tech giants, unfortunately, perhaps. Some of the brightest minds to come out of the education system in the world today are not curing cancer or figuring out how to put men on Mars. They're figuring out algorithms so that these people can make more money, which is a sad but true fact. But this brings me back to the privacy point, and obviously in New Zealand we do have privacy legislation. It might not cover some of these tech giants currently, but as a society as a whole, privacy is in there as one of those human rights that's expected. So people have been collecting data about us for years, right? So, you know, ever since Roman times, it's documented that there were, you know, census periods where people had to go to certain places and provide all of that information. In the UK, there was the Doomsday Book like 1,000 years ago. Even today, right, the government has the all of the census information about the citizens, all of your tax records, your health records are potentially held in some central government repository. And we have controls around that. We have protections and we have expected norms. As society, I used the point earlier, as a country, when our government agencies fail to handle our health information in the way that we expect them to, we're upset. That organization, proverbial heads will roll sort of thing as a result of it. So we do expect that. We have those norms in place. We have things like privacy legislation, certainly in New Zealand. We have things like privacy legislation to cover things like that. But for this, like the slightly scarier big data thing, those same controls don't necessarily extend to it. And that's where the society norms will need to kick back in again. And the way I was talking about how people need to behave online in the way they would in the real world, it's perhaps in the real world, it's a little bit more obvious when people are, you know, noticing or taking down information about you. They have to like come up to you in the street and like try and ask you questions, and you're like, why am I going to tell you my driving license number? Yeah. So but in the and obviously the government collects that sort of information, it's controlled, but the norms around how we use the internet still aren't quite there. So privacy is being challenged in my mind, obviously, as a new entrant into the internet space, and as social media starts to expand, well, has already expanded with so many of your young people already using it. It'll be interesting to see how you challenge that. The privacy legislation will go some ways towards it, but because the data about your citizen base is being collected by offshore people, I think that's where the broader internet community are going to need to rally together and try and establish some norms of behavior in how those big corporates use that data from a privacy perspective. So that was my thoughts on the context or privacy in the modern world. Obviously, it's a little bit broader than just New Zealand's perspective, but we do see those challenges in New Zealand. And not to scare you about social media, like I say, I do use it. I'm just a little bit more aware about how and when I use it and what I share on there. And then I'm perhaps less surprised when they target me for adverts with, hey, I was just looking at something like that 2 days ago. Shocking. Any questions? Or comments?
What would it be fair to understand that
Thank you. Would it be fair then to say that there's no such thing as privacy with the use of social media, and it only applies when someone is manipulating your account by hacking or creating fake IDs?
So there's two aspects to this in in my opinion, is people's use of social media. And it comes down to how the companies or other people behave. One, as an individual, when I use social media, I can control the limit to which other users of the same social media are able to see that information. And I should control that, probably. That's where that people need to behave. But also, I believe that if I just because I share something in an open way, that doesn't mean that other organizations should be able to therefore treat that as open source information that they can abuse. And targeting me for unsolicited advertising, in my opinion, is a degree of abuse. In the email world, we call it spam. And so, one, it's how the information is it used, and if that use is an abuse of rights or an abuse of privilege. So that's if other people are harvesting the information. And to some extent, I feel it's the same. It's that norm. So we've adopted these free platforms, and they've figured out a really clever way of commoditizing us. Effectively, we're the product, not the platform. And perhaps we, as a group of internet users, need to get used to the fact that perhaps we want to move to some micropayment system for that use. If in return they're not commoditizing our data in the back end, because obviously the platform needs to make money in some way for it to exist. But yeah, the way off needs to be if we're, you know, we have to challenge those companies around, but yes, we know you know all this about us, but it's not cool to be selling all of that about us to other people so that they can potentially, do annoying things or potentially bad things. So I think privacy still stands. You have to live your lives, you have to impart information that you might care about to other people. But we have to hold those people that have that information or access to the information to an accountability level in line with privacy legislation that we see on a national level. So those are the norms. But yeah, the data's still out there. You can't use the internet and be 100% private in your own bubble. Cool. Any other questions?
Okay, thank you very much, Barry, for that privacy presentation. Let's give him another applause again. We have one more presentation to go before we break out for morning tea, but just before that, I'd like to acknowledge some of our team who have just arrived. This is Sachat from DTCL, and we have Damien and Tom here from OneTalk. Thank you for joining us. And we also have our next presenter here who is Valentin. She came in after our introduction, so thank you. And we'll have Valentin here for our last session here before we break out. She is going to share a real-life experience of sort of cybercrime, as we can say, here in Vanuatu. Thank you, Valentin.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Valentine, and I'm a consumer of internet. Thank you, Team PRR, for inviting me to morning. I just want to share my experience this year with the internet. So early in February, I had my bank account, one of the banks. I think some of you know, you read in the paper, that somebody has transferred my money to another bank account within the bank. And I don't know how. And the bank has told me that it's through internet banking. They've asked me if my computer is secure. I said yes. And it's been dragging until today. They wrote to me last month to say, you can't refund your money. And the first place, I don't know where to go. So I went to the bank, they said, go to the police. I went to report to the police. Until today, the police said, it's still under investigation. And so I organized a meeting with OGCIO, TRR Reserve Bank, to go through this issue. And we still have to go through. We started and we haven't finished. And so I think we need to have a process for the victims. It's not only me, I know there's few people more that got this issue and just still stuck because we don't have a process where to go. So I'm asking if the authority can set a process. If someone got a problem, then just go through this process and to solve the problem. But it happened to me, and I'm in Villa, so I know where to go through all these people. But if it happens to somebody in the island, I don't know where they're going to go. There's hardly police station in the island. And by the time they take time from the island to come to Port Vila and report it, the money will be gone in the bank account. So this is my experience. I just want to share this short experience with all of you. So if I can get advice from some of you, that will be good. Like in some of your countries, how do you do to go if that process? So thank you.
Thank you so much, Valentin. I'm not sure whether Jackson, do you want to have a comment on that, or the police in general? Okay, very good.
Well, giving them time. So what happened, although it was reported to TRR, and we tried to take in the role and assist, but we couldn't because, you know, in the act it doesn't mention anything, you know, along that line. And to make the matter worse, it's also to do with content, and that's also outside the scope. That's also outside the scope of our role. So what happened is that we discussed, and which is why we're here today. What are the mechanisms that we together, internet community, but most importantly is for the financial organizations, because today most of the online activities are all, you know, related to finance, and that is where, you know, the incentive for people to come in and hack your information. So what can be done, you know, with all your contributions? Now she's there, she's waiting, and she's been checking what's next. And I don't know, we talked about privacy, the government, I don't know whether we have anything to do with privacy, you know, the policies or regulations or legislations, and if we do, then that's really good, so let's work together to enforce. But at the moment, I don't think so. In terms of telecommunications, in the TIA Act, it all make reference to cell phone, mobile, so, but not so much of internet. So any activities that happens, let's say, for example, if you have a smartphone and all these activities are happening, but it's all to do with data, unfortunately, for TIA's sake, you know, in terms of our consumer assistance and so forth, protection, it's very limited. So we might as well, you know, start work together and address this. Thank you.
Thank you very much, regulator. Any more comments on that? Jackson, thank you. You might need to stand face the camera and share your comments.
Okay, thank you, Andrew, and hello to our folks following us online. Just additional to what Dalcy has said, and also thanks to Fal for coming forward. We have, after this incident, formed a working group to tackle this issue on electronic fraud, and we are yet to formalize, and again, we can't do this on our own. It will need support from, for instance, issues relating to banks. The Reserve Bank is the regulator for all financial institutions, and they would be in a more better position to address issues such as what has been going on online fraud for banking especially. And again, our anticipation is for an establishment of a CERT, which is part of our discussions today, for us to have a CERT, and within the CERT, most preferably have it assigned at a location where it's easily accessible by all victims of any cybercrime activity. Yeah? So our preference is for it to be sitting with the police, and all our supporting partners will provide support to that office, especially to tackle issues such as this one. But we are not turning a blind eye. We are taking this very seriously to ensure that all our services, people enjoy online services, and whatever victims of any crimes, there's always the police, which is our first stop for any complaints or any reports that I need to be addressed.
Just taking, just want to comment on this. You know, we are putting the cybercrime bill, but I don't know if a cybercrime unit exists. Yeah, sorry. I just want to know if a cybercrime unit exists. This would have helped really, because the normal police would not be able to do this investigation. You really need, I think, a cybercrime unit in the police force. This is my comment.
My name is Edmund from Bank South Pacific. I think I've been with the bank for just over 3.5 years. Within the, this is just a comment on something that the regulators owe. If we were to create a cybercrime unit, just so that the participants in this symposium could understand from banking perspective. During my 3.5 years, I've come across online banking fraud. I've come across four which I actually investigated them. And out of these four is the customer who is a victim. The other one that funds would normally be transferred in the case of Valentine is transferred from her account to another. Is the other person that funds would normally be transferred to their account, the other ones that they've had their account on Facebook been hacked, or they've befriended some criminals that they didn't even know their background. So the pattern in the fraud that I've come across is these fraudsters or criminals would normally ask them, look, we've got some big funds here, we'd like to fund a charitable organization in your country. Give us your full details, your bank account. And by the time the criminals ask this question, they've already hacked the customer's internet banking password. Okay? And the message to our customers is, if you receive a fraudulent email asking you to update your internet banking password, don't ever click on that link that you received from that email. Because the risk is, as soon as you click on that link, you'll expose all your internet banking IDs, including all your bank accounts, to fraudsters or criminals. And this is where fraudsters have access to your internet banking password and all your accounts. So what they can do is, if you log on to your own internet banking, or whoever the bank is, the internet banking portal, yeah, the fraudsters have that similar access. They can view all your accounts. So the message is, don't ever respond to any hoax email or fraudulent emails that you received, and you don't even know who are the senders. Okay. And the content of these fraudulent emails is, they would normally ask you to update your internet banking password. And banks will never send any of their customers an email to update their internet banking passwords. And if you look at all the banks' internet banking portal is there's some information for the customers, what customers can do and what they cannot do. Okay. Out of these four that I've come across is our customers did the opposite. They went and did what under the internet banking policy to do with privacy is they went and did the opposite. Okay. So that's how from experiences how these four customers become victim of online fraud. Thank you.
Thank you, Edmond. Yes, thank you.
Donna from VFSC. I just wanted to ask the Vanuatu Police if they can comment on PVL's question concerning the cybercrime unit in the police force, or if OGCIO can inform us if there's an establishment of such a unit within the cybercrime legislation. Thank you.
Thank you. Uli from the Vanuatu Police Force. Yes, it's a big challenge. Since the Vanuatu Police Force, we've been working on the number of crimes. Since the past years, we've already established the money laundering unit. And with the current development on the cybercrime, yes, the Vanuatu Police Force will also have a unit, specific unit on that, that will work with other agencies. In the training development, we will work with our partners and see if we will train or we recruit qualified officers to work on that unit to support the services we are providing. Thank you.
Thank you. We'll have Kenton.
Thank you. I want to escalate the situation for having this cybercrime unit. I think it's imperative to have that unit for all stakeholders to sort of have a strong coordination and also inform the community. Me representing the community, I'm scared of the statistics that TRR and OGCIO presented on the presentation, where they said 10 years ago, the internet is slower. And for me, 10 years ago, we are safer. And intruders or cyber criminals trying to attack us 10 years ago, it would be very difficult for them because we are not online. 10 years gone, today, we have 20 gig speed of the internet, and that's faster for cyber criminals to catch the community, I mean, catch intruding into our system. In terms of the GDP, it's okay. We have economized the internet by impacting the GDP of the country. That's good. And then that 98 penetration, 10 years ago, it was 16% of the population being online on the internet. And we have less issues to do with to deal with cybercrime. Today, the vision of us going and fulfilling this universal access policy vision of 98% or penetration for internet for the rural community, I think it's 98% and safe as well, because everyone is going online. And that means we have to scale up capacity in cybercrime space. Also, we have to scale up on the ISP sector. TVL and Digicel are doing a great work, but at the same time, I think if they are concerned about the community, they should be providing some sort of awareness, like the banks are doing. And then the other one is farmers will be connecting soon. Farmers are concerned more too with productivity. But that productivity comes at a cost. If all the farmers in Vanuatu are not aware of these things, I think we are putting our country not forward, but sort of stagnant. We are now bogged down to deal with all sorts of unnecessary things that can also affect the productivity of the agricultural sector to do with things being online. So I think OTCIO and the community and the police and the ISPs and the banks need to sort of have this, what do they call it, cybercrime
working group.
Working group. And then as soon as possible, get it up and running and put some processes in place for the community to follow, to be security conscious and as well stay safe online, especially children too. Thank you.
Thank you, Kenton. I think that is very important for everyone to work together. Thank you, regulator.
And that should be the quick win of today's discussion. What, you know, instead of waiting for the cybercrime unit at the police, and instead of waiting for the banks to go out, and instead of waiting for TIAB to go out and visit all the communities to do a lot of awareness, what can be done as an outcome of today's quick win? One is an awareness, and then secondly is what, you know, what can the operators, for example, can do to assist in here? What can the banks through the regulator, Reserve Bank, can do to assist? And let's all contribute together and move forward. But we have an opportunity here where we can get, you know, Barry's maybe some models that they used in New Zealand or others, you know, maybe OneTalk who has some, or Digicel or TVL or Bank Pacific, Bread, National Bank. I'm pretty sure you have some kind of models, but share and then let's work together to, you know, to fight this out. Thank you.
Thank you. I think I will have to let everyone go now for a break. If you have more questions, we'll have more time at the break and we'll provide some opportunities for questions and discussion. Thank you. in a short while. And as if you can see in your agenda, it is our first panel discussion. Our panel discussion will relate very much to the sessions that we had this morning on social media and cybersecurity. So we're fortunate to have few individuals here who will be here as our panelists, and I will call them now. We have Kenton Milroy from Fighters. We have Sachat Ahmed from DigiCell, Barry Braley from DNC, and myself from TRR. Our moderator for this first session will be Jackson. So I'd like to now welcome our panelists in front and our moderator, Jackson. Thank you.
So I will now ask briefly our first question is on security and relating to specifically on Facebook. So the first question is, how secure in your views, representing the technical community, from the community, consumer, and also from administrators of domain names, how secure is Facebook?
Thank you, Jackson. We are not, I am not an expert in Facebook security, but rather, as a user of Facebook, I've been using Facebook for about 7 or 8 years now. I don't normally put out comments on Facebook. I just follow. I just get in there and see what's happening over the years. And yes, I've seen quite a lot of improvement that Facebook have done over the years. But I wouldn't say that it is fully secure at this stage. But I believe we have other views as well. But to me, Facebook, although it may be seem secure, but in itself, we could have questions to ourselves or to Facebook saying, is the platform really secure? Really, I couldn't answer that question myself. Probably Facebook would have their view, we would have our views, but then what's common? Thank you.
Thank you, Jackson. Thank you, Andrew. So the from Facebook's perspective, I'm sure that their security is good, that they they know how to protect the data that they see as valuable. The issue, I guess, at a user level is that a lot of the activity on Facebook, it's how they designed it to be. It's supposed to be a sharing and open platform. As a user of Facebook, the biggest gripe that I have, and I hear it from my wife as well, and we're always conscious of it, is that in order to be secure, Facebook has to do a lot of code updates and code pushes, and they're forever pushing to that out. So either their main web page or their social media apps on the phone, lots and lots of small code pushes. And quite often, in those little code pushes, they actually decide to change all of the privacy and security settings. And so despite when you first set up your Facebook account, you've gone in and you've set the, I don't want to share this, and only people that I know are allowed to see these things about me. And because of their terms and conditions around how they're allowed to update their own code, a few months later, through no fault of your own, those settings have actually been reset to something that perhaps you didn't select. Now, I know Facebook probably don't intend to do that, and it's a byproduct of their security and stuff, but it is one of the security annoyances that I see with Facebook, and I kind of don't like it. When people change settings that I've deliberately chosen, I kind of think that's bad, and I send them nasty emails if I have to. That's my main concern with Facebook security.
Thank you, Jackson. How secure is Facebook? I think I want to look at it from the psychological perspective by asking this question myself. What's the level of when it comes to the sphere of security consciousness? Personally, I need to assess myself. What's the level of my security consciousness to do with me? That's the first line of defense before asking this question, looking at Facebook and asking, Facebook, how secure are you, Facebook? How secure are you, Facebook? I need to ask the question to myself. How secure are you, Kenton? From there, then I take the security from my side to Facebook. If I'm security conscious, then I would be very cautious on my affiliation, on my activities online. I've got so many stories about Facebook here. Myself and some other groups, especially with Minister of Infrastructure, Chodam Napat, we sort of use Facebook to fight against NCD, non-communicable disease. That's a big mobility of people every 4:30 in the morning, up to 6. So that's one benefit of Facebook, but in terms of the security, I want to look at it as a software engineer by profession. Facebook is using a JavaScript framework called React.js. JavaScript, if you look it up on Stack Overflow, JavaScript is one of the most popular programming languages, especially with the popularity of the internet. So JavaScript, is JavaScript secure? No, JavaScript, there are lots of code snippets. When just kids can use JavaScript snippets to sort of do SQL injection and find vulnerabilities on the Facebook and also on the Messenger on the phone. When it comes to having Messenger for Facebook on your phone, I think recovering password is very easy these days with phone. You lose your phone on the bus, I take all of your phone, I reset your Facebook password, and then I take control of your account. So I don't think, to me, I might be wrong, Facebook is not secure. It depends on how secure you are when it comes to you yourself thinking about it. By the way, Barry, I'm a member of the New Zealand Institute of IT Professionals. Yeah, I was in Christchurch and member also for JavaScript community and .NET community. And we've come across these sort of cyber security seminars and weekly updates. It's good. You've got a vibrant community down there in New Zealand. Thank you.
Okay, so like all the panel members have already discussed their experience, so the same thing I will just put on to 2 or 3 points like the boss said. First is, it's not secured. Why it's not secured? Anything which is going against your privacy or without your approval or authorization, that's not secured. And you can see, like simply, I don't know if anyone here knows, WhatsApp and Facebook, they are together now.
And on WhatsApp, there is, if you update your WhatsApp now, there will be a clause or a term which comes up that WhatsApp have rights to access your Facebook profile. Normally, if you read those terms and conditions, nobody read it. Actually, you just say accept. And when you click accept, within there, there are 100 of clause which you don't even understand WhatsApp. They automatically, you give access to WhatsApp or to Facebook that they can access all your profile. And like they mentioned it before, Facebook is not charging you any money. WhatsApp, they are not making any money from you. Digicel, TVL, when you are using it, when you make a call or send a text message, it's a cost. Why? Because you are using it and we are providing security. We are 100% sure nobody else access it. If something we give, even the CDR, which we call it the call detail record, so if Digicel want to give call detail record to someone, we will get a police warrant or a case or something in writing from the authorities, then we can only release the data. Whereas WhatsApp, when you send a text message or using it for data or for call, it's free. But the question is, for a layman, how they are making the money, where this money is coming from, why they are giving it for free. So where the money is coming from, it was already discussed in the previous session, they are making money from the other business on the advertisement. How the advertisement is coming in, it's like, again, the big data. Where this big data is coming in, you click Havana Resort on your profile and you like it, the other person knows that you are in Havana, and these are the resorts, which is one of the good resorts. So Havana Resort has already been advertised through Facebook now. So the next time if someone is coming to Vanuatu, they might think, okay, that was one of the good resorts where this TRR did at some event or something, they will wish to come here. So it's automatically a money source for Havana. So in that way, from my side, I will say it's not secure. Reason, everyone, they have access to your profile. Without your authorization, they are using your data. They are giving access to WhatsApp, to Facebook. So WhatsApp and Facebook, they are one today. Maybe tomorrow there will be WhatsApp and LinkedIn and Facebook and Yahoo. They will acquire two or three more businesses. So if they acquire more businesses, you have different profiles on all. You are sharing one account for your professional contacts and one is only for your friends and family. But they will have access to both and they can use it for you. And the same, initially, like we discussed, the Prime Minister of Vanuatu has 6 accounts. So who is using it and what is the purpose of that and how we can control it, there is no guarantee. On another issue, like the Facebook, I don't know, sometime you will see an unknown post is posted on your timeline. So where it's coming from, whether it's intentional or Facebook is doing it or they are using it for the money or it's a security issue for them, but in any case, it's not secure. If someone can post something on your posted timeline, it's not secure. You cannot trust it. So all these things, at the end, the conclusion will be it's not secured. You cannot use it for your accounting information, your banking things, your for layer, for entertainment, yes. For the context to the family friends, you can do it. But that's it. Anything more than that shouldn't be. Thank you.
Thank you, Sachat. I will open the floor briefly before we go to our next question. If anyone has any views on security and Facebook that they would like to share. Okay, while you're still, okay. Jethro at the back.
I can make a comment on the Facebook security. The way I observe it, I use Facebook, and however, I'm very conscious of how I use Facebook these days. And within Facebook itself, there are security features which you can turn on. It doesn't mean that you get into Facebook, you're automatically safe. Though those security features are there, a lot of them are disabled. They're not turned on by default. And it's something that you have to turn on manually. So if you're, like, it depends on also on what you want to use Facebook for. And if you are someone who is conscious of security, then the first thing you would want to do is to make sure you turn on all these security features that are available, and then so that you can be more secure as you use Facebook. And also you have to be aware. I think most users, especially in Vanuatu, where internet is something that is relatively new to the community in Vanuatu. And so people just get online because of large portion of the people are using Facebook. Everyone wants to get on. But they do not know about the risk that exists on Facebook. They just post anything. They food or their family, their household photo, their pet, anything. Basically, give up all the information to the internet. And so I think people, especially within the community in Vanuatu, they are not really aware of the risk that exists when they use Facebook, especially when it comes to security. Perhaps more awareness, perhaps, on the risk that exists on Facebook, so that people will be more conscious of how they use Facebook. Thank you.
Thank you, Jethro.
It's, the point Jethro makes is actually quite good. It's possibly something that if you had a cert or one of those things in place, that's the kind of advice like this that they could put out or have available for the community. What I see in New Zealand, a lot of large corporates now have moved towards advising all of their staff how to configure things like their Facebook accounts and how to configure things like their LinkedIn accounts and the things to look out for when they're using those social media. Because as Jethro says, the settings that people should be using are not on by default. And so you either have to try and find your way through the app, because Facebook don't want to tell you to turn these things on necessarily. I suspect they don't want to tell you, my opinion. So a couple of pages of information with the little screenshots that just show you, go here, change this to that, lock that so that only you can write onto your timeline or your friends or whoever you want. And to take you through all the different things that you should look at. That's the kind of advice that it would be good if it was available publicly, but certainly large corporates in New Zealand are putting that advice out. It's useful, it's common sense advice. These companies aren't going to change their settings, so we need to help people. And obviously this room probably has looked at the settings, because we're probably a self-selected audience of people that are perhaps a little bit tech savvy and care about security, whereas most people that are using these things perhaps aren't. So it's a good idea. Someone should publish that.
Thank you. Jackson, I also want to add on to the question, how secure is Facebook, to ask another question. What can we do to secure ourselves on Facebook? We need to secure ourselves. That's the first line of good thinking. The next thing is, what information do we want to secure or protect? In that sense, I'm trying to mean, what information do you want to post? Like he stated in his statement, what information do I want to post, and which information I'm not supposed to post? Facebook came into Vanuatu and it shot the culture of Vanuatu right on the head. Vanuatu has a culture that is different from other places in the region. We've got a place called Nakamal, where only certain people can go there. We got a place at home, but only some information can be shared among the members of the family. It's not like in Western society where some of the, for example, when it comes to reproductivity, some of those information are never mentioned in the homes in Vanuatu until you go to an age of maybe 22 or 23, 24 upwards, then you get those information. While in Western society, you get this information at 12, 10 years old, 12 and upwards. So we need to be also coming out from this culture. We need to also, I do not know how we're going to go on, to address this, but we need to respect our culture as well when dealing on Facebook. Vanuatu has a unique culture, and I think it's very valuable. It might be different, and it might oppose some other thinking of other societies and cultures. But I think when it comes to securing our culture, we also, securing your personal information is one, and securing your culture is also another thing. Because I do not want other people in other countries to be copying our traditional totems and stories and all this stuff. These are copyright information. Though we do not have an official document to safeguard it, but we can do it, we can play our part. So, yeah, there are many things to secure from outside too. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Kendon. I think his question leads on to the next discussion that we were going to ask the panel. It's on privacy issues when using social media. So from our first discussion, we have our pros and cons on security, especially relating to Facebook. We do conclude that Facebook is not secured. We have to be conscious about our security, mainly the type of information we put out. And also Sachat has mentioned an important point, especially on end user agreements. This is what you find when you sign up for service, either it be Facebook or accessing certain websites or etc. And it has this accept and decline button. And I am 100% sure that all of us here never read what's in that end-user agreement. One, it's very long. It takes you probably 15 to half an hour to read that. And being service demand-driven people, we don't have time to read through all this. But if you have some time to have a read through this, it does mention quite a lot of information. And one being that your information may be shared to other third parties, which is something we overlook many times and we don't take into consideration. And also Barry has raised a very good point on company policies, mainly on securities guidelines for training staff on proper use of social media, which is happening already in our neighboring country, New Zealand, and I am sure if there are ways that we can push this further in Vanuatu, we can also be able to take this path. Now, coming back to our discussion and our good question raised by Kenton, what are some of the privacy issues when using social media? So privacy issues relates to your name, your identity. Your identity brings up your religious views, and I think it's all the information that was on one of Barry's slides, your name, your gender, your date of birth, where you live, your telephone number. So what are some issues when using social media? So I won't talk much. I will go around the panel to get their views on privacy and social media.
Okay, I'll start again. Thank you, Jackson. I think we could agree that we are all social beings, and so also agree that we prefer some privacy of some sort in life, and that is a fact for us. And as Kenton had mentioned, maybe a decade ago or so, there were no issues with this. But now, we are being invaded with this service that has put our attention on something different while
using our privacy to, as sort of, we pay the price with our privacy. And I was in a session where privacy issues were discussed, and there was an example. Yeah, we're talking social media here, but when you give your information, for example, when you go to get a driver's license, you give all your information, your date of birth, your everything. And what is the responsibility of that organization once they receive your privacy information? That is still here the question. But as Jackson had said, that in a local setting like the government, we do have some control. Also, Chad has mentioned that. Like DHCL, if you want something, you need a police a court order to have call details given. But in social media, there's no privacy, and people are not aware to what extent their information can be used in social media. And we have learned that it can be sold. So we have a big issue here, especially in Vanuatu. While the internet is growing, comes these privacy issues. And at TRR, we have done some, we had some information given to the community through posters and other things. There's one particular information card, poster, which is on Facebook alone, and we're trying to distribute as much of the poster into the community to understand the risk to do with Facebook. So really, this is an issue that is uncontrollable, but we can only talk about it. Maybe I'll stop right here.
So I've talked a bit about privacy issues and social media already this morning. I suppose that for me, the biggest issue that I see is people not being aware in their use, which we've already touched on in general. The next issue is it's okay the using the driving license example as a good analogy. It's okay if people are using social media in this way. The real issue, the real privacy-related issue, is if that data is then actually being abused. Mm. And it depends where you draw the line in what's abuse. And maybe marketing isn't considered abusive, and maybe it is. I suppose the biggest issue is how the data is subsequently used. So people need to gather data in order to provide you services or to allow you to do things, and that's acceptable, but that data then needs to be only used for the reasons in which it was collected, and that's a big driving thing. And it is starting to take effect. I don't know if you notice on your phone now, you constantly get that, do you want to allow this app to use location services and to use these? And that's actually a privacy setting that they've had to put in because of society saying we're not happy with you surveilling us wherever we go. And so I guess that as we identify these things that we're less comfortable with, it's important to make noise about it. But abusing the data is the biggest issue from my perspective.
Privacy issues. I think there are a lot of privacy infringement that we are committing in Vanuatu when it comes to Facebook from our end. But we are not aware of it. Some people are using out my data, if I'm talking about me, my gender, my food, my pictures, my anything that I posted on my timeline for commercialization of my data, and without my knowledge. So from my side, I'm posting. From their end, it's more of this commercialization of the data. They are consuming it for economizing and for business continuity, while I'm not getting any profit from it. So when they are using, big data is a big thing now. They are using it for visualizing, they are visualizing data for each country so that they can predict the trend of the food we eat,
what are we going to do next, the trend of everything that is happening in Vanuatu by aggregating all the data, putting it in one place. I think when it comes to privacy issues, we might be securing out the data from our end, but when it comes to building, Facebook is continually under refinement, the features. Some couple of years ago, you only have this like button. Now you have this, you touch the like button and it comes up with all sorts of icons and stuff. It's evolving. It's under continuous refinement. And those continuous refinement comes by millions of fixing bugs, millions of lines of code, people putting in code every day, every second, and then pulling out code, putting it in. And they are doing all sorts of things. But I think those people who are developing the software are not mindful about the fact that those lines of code can also affect and expose privacy data from a user and of the channel. So I think having the cybercrime working group, we need to have some sort of understanding that software which is under day-to-day refinement, upgrading of their software features, are most riskier software, because there are lots of things being done seconds by seconds. And we might be posting the right thing, we might be posting the right sort of information, but we do not know what's happened behind the scene. That's the darkest room, and it's full of, I would say, devils. Yeah, so I'm nervous. At the same time, I'm excited that Facebook is giving us this liberalization of marketing our product. We can market our product easily. We can spend 1 vatu, 50 vatu on the TVL data and digital data to market my kumala, my taro, my banana, my anything, fish. At the same time, I'm also scared of those devils when it comes to privacy issues. Thank you.
Thank you very much, boss. Okay, so the question, I think the second one, it's almost linked to the first one also. What are the issues, and especially the social media? I will refer it to what happened to Valentine. I don't think there is an issue with the bank system, or they will leak the information, username or password. How it goes out, it's just a mistake, a user mistake. Where you go onto a website, or you are on a social media, or any link, where it leaks, refer it to another link, and you by mistake you input all your information. So this is how the other guy will use those information and use your username, password, and log into your banking system and transfer whatever amount they want to use. So this is of course a risk, and that's the biggest issue. But it's come back to what Jethro said. It's a risk for those who are not aware of how to use it. And 80% people or 70% people in Vanuatu, I will say, they don't know more about internet, or especially when they are coming first time. When you get used to it, it's not a problem. But when you are using it for the first time, you just like Jackson said, you click on accept whatever the terms and condition, and if it takes you to the next page, you go on to that one. So banking, it's the biggest risk. Your financial risk, that's one. The other one, it's a bit of funny from my experience also. Something which you want to share with your girlfriend, let's say, with your wife, with your boss, those things you don't want to share with your friends. Or those things which you want to share with your friend, you don't want to share with your boss or those people which are totally private. So Facebook doesn't allow, there are settings, but normally users don't know. Anyone can tag you on any photo. You are in that bar last night, and it's been tagged, and next morning you come and say, oh, I was in a club. I was with my friend, but you are already been tagged, and someone is watching you there where you are, and you are not aware of that. So those kind of issues which is not in your control, it take away all the privacy from you. You allowed your friend, there is a setting which allow others to tag you also. They can tag you and you won't know, and next morning maybe you will be in trouble. So similar to that, I think normally the big organization, before it was LinkedIn where they want to go and see what you do or what is your experience. But now if you want to hire someone, you don't go on LinkedIn, you just go on Facebook and see what he has done in the last 1 year. So your timeline shows for the last 5 years or whatever period of time you are using,
And that's the full history of not your education or not your qualification, but it's what kind of person you are. And there may be some positive and negative things. If you are 100%, nobody is perfect. If you are 100% perfect, maybe you will get an opportunity. But if you judge yourself, you do 80 good things, but sometimes you are in a bad mood, or sometimes you do something with friends which is not good for the business. And if your profile see that information, it become a problem for you for the jobs also. So it's come back to the same point which Jethro mentioned, how you want to use it, how you want to share it. And if you leave it open, what the way Facebook is doing it, it's a risk. Social risk, financial risk, for your professional life risk, there are different issues which can be a problem for anyone. And that's it. Thank you.
Thank you, panel. I now open up for any comments. Brett at the back, and then we'll get the file.
Thank you. So, Jade, you made some good points, so I'm going to put one back at you and probably to our other carrier friends. As part of your deal, you give away free Facebook. So you're saying, Sajjad, that people need to be educated about how to use Facebook. Then don't you think it's beholden on you as giving away free Facebook to actually help educate people how they should actually use it?
Okay, so again, thanks for the question, but both from DGCL, TVL, or all of us who are using social media, if we are giving it free, people like it. If we stop giving it, it's an opportunity, okay, move out to those who can give it for free. Second thing is, it's a user responsibility how they want to use it. It's a user level access what they want to control. So service provider are just giving access, but we cannot control that. Yeah, maybe there is a way if someone want to log in, if you are sending a free Facebook message, we can send go through this link for the setting purpose also. But it's become very difficult. Educating people, it's not easy. And giving free Facebook, you get more customers. That's e-marketing. That's about how you can get more customers, how you can get more people to use your services. So whether we do it free of cost, Facebook is doing free. DigiCell is, I don't think it's anymore full free, but even if it is free, it's good for the customer and people are using it.
Thanks, Sajjad. We'll get the next question from Fal.
Well, I just want to share another experience. Like Andrew said, we can't control these things. Somebody got my picture from, I don't know where, the internet or something, and then just put on the business card and said, okay, we got this to offer. And I didn't know about it. And somebody came to me and said, is this you? Are you working for this person? I said, no, I'm not. So I said, we can't control. Somebody else took your picture, put on there, and then somebody else take it and put it. So these things, like, I don't think can control.
So your information provided, the panelists, thank you very much for all the very good information you're providing based on your experiences. And the level of the information provided, you know, will fit into those who really understand what, you know, we are talking about, and particularly those who have, you know, interacts with Facebook and also laptops and internet, you know, often. But there are some people, I think majority of the people now who are youth in Vanuatu, okay, in Vanuatu, who are youth, are also outside, you know, those category. And they don't have access to laptops, they don't have access to tablets, but the only gadget that, you know, it's easier for them to purchase is handset. And they are really into smartphone, okay? And in smartphone, when you log up to Facebook, you know, some of the features that you're talking about, say, for example, Chetra mentioned about, you know, turning on your security something. So some of them you don't have to, you know, the opportunity to access that in your Facebook, in a cell phone. So what would be your advice to those people? You know, I'm one of them. I'm just looking at, you know, this smartphone. I'm trying to find out where can I find this, but it's taking a lot of my time, but that's me. But now I'm talking about these people who don't really understand and, you know, maybe catching up.
So you can, and it's maybe just encouraging them to use Google, which again is also taking the data that they've just used in that search and selling it about them. But you can actually Google, and people have shared online the screenshots around how to get through. Sometimes with the privacy settings on the handset, as well as doing them inside the Facebook app, you also need to go into the phone itself. And there's all the background sharing settings on the phone that you just want to turn off. So obviously, it's Facebook want to know, especially when you are a mobile user, they love the fact that you're on that handheld device. They want to know exactly where you are, and that's how they know where you are, so you can check into places, right? It's a cool feature. So they don't want you to disable that because they think it enriches your experience, so you probably have to try and turn that off on the phone. But yeah, Googling, encouraging people to Google whatever their problem is, and invariably someone's already shared a few pictures of how to fix some of those things. Either that it would be a useful add-on to the schools. So Jackson mentioned that 30% of school children had had some security training in the scheme, encouraging the school at a school level, because 100% of them had used Facebook, right? Or 90% or something. So encouraging them at that level to understand about these settings. They might not care, but at least they know that there are settings there as opposed to just grab app, use it. That's mine. Yeah, maybe in the school level would be a good point.
Okay, so thanks. And then in addition to that, given that some of the consumers are aware that they have done mistake in there, they've put up the pictures or some information that they know it's already wrong. Is there any possibility? I know I'm talking, but I know there are some principals out there on the click centers now who are listening. So that will also help them to pass on the message. Huh? So is there any opportunity for them to delete the message and it's all deleted? What's the simple response to that one for our students' sake and the youth sake?
I think for the Facebook or any account wherever you are posting, you are the only person who can delete it. If you are a user, you can delete it from your account. And you go on to your timeline, let's say on Facebook, you can delete it. And even there are options where you don't want to delete it, but you want to select few users who can only see it, or you can keep it to yourself. So normally, if you are posting something, it will ask you three things, which are it's only for friends, only for you, or you can share it with anyone. So if you are going into settings, of course, you need to log in from a laptop, which is more easy. If you are doing it from your mobile, a smartphone can be done, but it's a bit hard. But deleting things, hiding things, or selecting the viewers who can access it, it's all possible through Facebook. And on WhatsApp or Viber or all those things, it's only friend who can access it. And if you are using WhatsApp for the first time, you will even see it's encrypted. So just like Skype was one of the encrypted version where you are sending your message, it's fully encrypted. WhatsApp is also encrypted now, but not all the social media apps, whatever you are sending, it's not encrypted. It means someone can access it, what you are sending, so it's not fully secured. Yeah.
If you're talking about offensive or malicious or bullying comments that have been posted or stuff, Facebook can pull those down, because it will be in breach of their terms and conditions. So you don't even need local legislation that it's in breach of. It's probably, if it's offensive material offensive messages that are being used for bullying and taunting. And that's where the relationship that I think Jackson mentioned, and probably you guys here, unfortunately you have to have a direct relationship with Facebook. And normally, in New Zealand we have an entity called NetSafe, a team, and they have a very good working relationship with Facebook. And so for all of those online harm type issues that they address, there are 95-99% of the issues, Facebook removes it. And that means that it's properly gone. It might have been cached in some places. It could lurk around. Facebook already isn't cool because people like me are using it, I suppose. Or once your grandmother joined, is Facebook cool anymore, right? So the kids are off using the next one, which means that
well, UTRR and the GCIO and the CERT or the police need to constantly try and keep up with all of that. That's complicated. Again, that's where those big tech companies need to be held to it.
I think one of the features in Facebook is reporting. It is a very good feature, and I have asked that question once to Facebook. When you report something, because you can actually report anything, when you report it, do they see it as coming from your profile or not? And the answer I got was that it is anonymous. When you report something, they do not know who reports it, but they would know the details of what you have reported. How true is that? I'm not sure, but that's what I got from Facebook.
That's a very cool mic. Anyway, about the deleting of stuff, I think most young people, including some of us in this room, need to be aware that we have to think before we do something. You don't do something and then think and then recreate later on. Directing the next door movie, the Kiwi guy. So that's one good experience for Facebook. Things going viral on Facebook. When things go viral on Facebook, it's very hard to delete. Especially Facebook got this capability or behavior where you share things. And some of those things are not shared on Facebook itself, but shared to other third-party applications. I'm using Slack. Slack is sort of a social media platform, a collaborative one, and I've got rooms inside. I can integrate Facebook as a third-party application where things are posted on my timeline. My friends are following me on Slack. Bye-bye for you. You can happy and jumping up and down. You are deleted, but we are still following you on our Slack room. So I think deleting stuff on Facebook or any sort of social media is quite difficult because of the viral capability of the post being spread in seconds. So yeah, I don't think deleting things won't solve the problem of privacy too. Thank you.
Thank you, Kenton. Any more questions from the audience? Fred.
Thank you, Jackson. I hope I'm not deviating from the topic, but I'm more concerned with privacy issues. I think Andrew mentioned a little that with regards to services provided by PTCL and otherwise for courts. My question is, does that also apply to text messages? And does PTCL have a database that contains all text messages of people using the TTCL services?
Thanks for the question. Okay, like as I mentioned, anything, whether it's TTCL or TVL or any telecom company, including Facebook also, the information are coded. It's encrypted. So when it's encrypted, when it goes between the two users, we cannot read it. And if we read it or if anyone is doing it, it's illegal. So first thing is it's not possible. Second, whether how we can do it, it goes through the police and it goes through the legal process. We customer can only get, like if you are a customer, you will get your CDR month. If you are a postpaid customer, by month end you will get the bills, where you have called, what was your duration, how much it's charged you. So those information are your data. This is totally related to you. But if you want to see how many times I called you or where I'm calling, then this information is not available for you. Only the user can access it. But if police want to get that information, for example, where I'm calling in, our care team, they get all those details, and then they can provide all the information for the calls, outgoing calls. Like you can see, currently, I think DGCL and TVL both, we have a feature where you can call someone by hiding your number also. So when you hide your number, other
people from our online users.
Abuse threatening and online abuse, like any other normal criminal activity that happens in the physical world. These are governed under respective laws, and the ones done over the internet are also covered under the new cybercrime bill. Thank you. Any other questions from the floor? I am mindful of our time. We have about 34 more minutes to discuss and deliberate on this session before we...
Just to respond to Fred's comments, they are very important comments, and we've got a response from Sajjad. But in TR's case, TR also has the power to get the information, but it's only for the TRs or the regulatory's investigation. And you know, whatever information that you wish to have, for example, for your investigation, it has to go through the police. Unless it deals with the regulatory matters, then that's when we can, you know, the TR can use its power to obtain that information. Okay, thanks.
Thank you. My question goes like this. Such as you mentioned something about customers calling, they can hide the caller ID. What is the process you have if I come to you and ask if you can open my caller ID from my side? If anyone calls, I can still view the number even though he called private. Is there any process that you have in place for that?
Okay, so on that one, for incoming, if you want to open it, it's
so I think it is important that while social media or Facebook is a great tool to use, at the same time, it can be abused by somebody there watching us. And I think we have talked about that, but I'm really directing this to those who are following in the UAP sites around the islands. Thank you.
Thank you, Andrew. For the points, and just coming back to our discussion on security and privacy issues relating to social media, we can all agree that most users around Vanuatu are not taking their security seriously. For instance, something I do once in a worrying is just search for yourself on Google, for example. Just type your name, you'll see your name appearing in all sorts of places, or even in Facebook itself. Just search for your even if they're strangers. When someone new comes to your village and they start talking about, oh, I'm from here, people very easily trust those people. So the same concept also applies to the internet. We easily now take any final comments from the audience, if there's any, and then we'll take final comments from the panelists before we close the session and break out for lunch. So again, I open up the floor to anyone for any final comments or questions. Okay, seems like there's none, so we'll proceed to closing remarks from our panelists. This time we'll start from Sajjad, and Andrew will give the final comments before we close the session.
I think the other party CEO, okay, the guy's already reading the messages now, so they will call you also. But all, it's come to the setting. When you know how to use it, it's okay. If you are not aware of things, other can abuse it, and that's it.
I would like to conclude the fact that mobile devices in the hands of most Nivans, on which phone you are, what you post, we need to protect our families.
We need to protect our country. As a business, you need to protect your business. As an employee, you need to protect your reputation, because you will not be in the same position until you retire. You want to migrate to other positions. Be careful of what you post on LinkedIn. Look to other people, and people might have perception on you, and now you start having this sort of stress. Oh, people are looking at me with this sort of perspective. You yourself cause it by posting nasty things on social media. I would not like to exclude other social media platforms. Facebook is one. Facebook is not the only one. Twitter, LinkedIn, YouTube. YouTube has a blocking system where people post things against a video. And some of those posts, especially if you look at the BBC channel and Discovery Channel and the RT one, Russian television, with the ongoing situation in Syria, there are lots of swearing there. You do not want your kids to go to that link, because under them there are lots of threats on those channels. So you might not be posting, but you're reading things, digesting things. It might ruin your whole being, because the more you read bad things, you become a bad guy or bad girl yourself. So that's all I can say. Play safe on the internet. Thank you.
So we've covered quite a bit of it already. I suppose it's about people taking responsibility for their own actions, as Canton was saying, but it's also about giving people the tools, and by tools I mean the real world tools, the understanding and the advice to help them make those correct decisions. And it goes back to the points I was talking about in my earlier presentations around that different behavior that we see online, and this is why online bullying has become a different problem, although the same problem, it's become a larger problem than real world bullying was. And it's because the message spreads far and wide, and there's different education and awareness and a knowledge that needs to be imparted starting from the young. We're talking about the young people as well. That's potentially the next growing issue in this area that we're starting to see in New Zealand. So some of those tech giants that I talked about earlier offer specific suites of tools intended for schools. So as you move to a more connected society with better provisioning of internet services to your education facilities, those schools are going to want to make use of cloud services, etc. And suddenly all of your children's assignments and all of their school records are also being stored by those same tech giants. So those advertising companies can start building your profile from the minute you enter the education system going forward. And so that's probably something that you're going to have looming in the future as well, in how that data is used. And I guess that's possibly an easy...
Each of us here and those out there listening have the responsibility to share the information. And I want to highlight that we have the power as a people. We have access to Facebook. What if you post from time to time all this issue on your timeline or in a group like Yumi Talk Talk Straight? Then the information is shared, awareness is shared among the people. So you share one information about privacy and concerns, 30,000 people will see it, and that's good. That's good. At least they're reading it. So what I'm saying is, even though we are concerned with the privacy and security issues, we can also make use of that network to inform people about it. And one of the things that I want to finish off is that we should be looking at social media and the internet, as I think Barry mentioned, had a picture up there that Big Brother is watching, in that